What is the paper weight?
Well, we do welcome you today, and when Gaius made it share something this morning, one verse came to mind almost immediately, and that's Psalm 116:15. And the verse reads, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful servants." Psalm 116 is a psalm of thanksgiving. The psalmist was confident that since he was a covenant person, God would always view him as precious. The word precious has to do with the intrinsic and genuine worth of something. You see, today, there are only two classifications of people: those who are in Christ and those who are not in Christ. What do those terms mean? Someone in Christ is someone who has repented of their sins and have placed their faith in the sacrificial death of Jesus Christ on the cross. Someone not in Christ is someone who has not placed their faith in Christ. Perhaps they want to get to God their own way, or may not believe in God. Choosing to believe something is true does not make it true. We find one of the clearest verses on God's motivation for why God, for why Jesus came to die on the cross for us in John 3:16, where he said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." And so today, as we celebrate Bob's life, I want you to remember this. In God's eyes, he was precious. He was of great worth. And if you're in Christ, you are too. Amen.
Count all the blessings from the store.
a joy for me to get to share a little bit of Bob's wonderful life with you. Thank you, Gay, for affording me this opportunity. I had the privilege of being Bob's doctor these past few years. I originally met him through his wife. Gay and I started working together in February of 1996. God in his providence brought Gay to me when my practice was circling the drain, and he used Gay to revive me as she brought an air of confidence everywhere she went. I was always so grateful to Gay for the early mornings and late nights, working through lunch without complaining. I didn't realize at the time that I really needed to thank Bob for keeping the home fires burning so that Gay could be available the way she was. At the time, RD was a little boy. Gay's mother was in the home, and Gay wouldn't have been able to work with me if Bob hadn't been willing to carry his weight and then some at home. Gay always said that Bob was born with wheels rather than feet attached to his ankles. It was almost second nature for him to carry his weight and then some, as he was always working and moving and accomplishing things. In fact, it took a stroke to finally slow him down, and it was only then that any of us realized that he had feet, not wheels, attached to his ankles. Bob was fourth from the youngest in a line of 14 children born to a poor farming family in North Carolina. There were 7 girls and 7 boys. Little Bob was dragging his cotton sack by the age of 6 with the rest of the family. He plowed with an old mule and picked tobacco. Bob even made his own cigar from tobacco in the field and smoked it, but it made him so sick that he never smoked again in his entire life. He had polio at age 8, and his father took him to the mountain doctor and worked diligently with his crippled boy. Over time, Bob recovered dramatically and went on to play championship football in high school. As a teenager, one night at a revival service, Bob was drawn by the Holy Spirit to repent of his sins and surrender to Christ. In his own words, he was marked for life as God's own from then on. He shared this experience with me on several occasions, telling me how he was simply unable to refuse the urge to go forward at the end of the service that night. He was the recipient of God's irresistible grace. By the time he graduated from high school, Bob had seen all he ever cared to of farming or working in the local factories. Opportunity came knocking. As the best football player on his championship team, he was offered 4 football scholarships, but chose to join the Navy instead. His father was angered by this decision, such that he made Bob go live with his grandparents until the beginning of boot camp. That took him to Nashville, where his great musical skills refused to rest. It was there that he met and played with the man known as country music's foremost entertainer, Little Jimmy Dickens, as well as many other country singers. In fact, he was able to sit in on many of their bands, and he even played at the Grand Ole Opry. Bob had an amazing ear for music. He was a magician with most stringed instruments, though the fiddle was his favorite. We are hearing some of Bob's music today. We tried to get him to play his fiddle here at church, but it was after his stroke, and he didn't want to play if he couldn't play as well as he always had. Wherever he was, Bob rose to the top. He was one of the first Navy SEALs. He served there until Admiral Stump needed a communications officer, and he called on Bob to fill that role. After leaving the Navy, he worked with the FAA as an air traffic controller for 33 years. Upon retirement as an air traffic controller, he was urged by the FAA to be their teacher at a training school in Palm Coast, Florida. He taught there for 8 years and then moved to the Wiregrass area in 1995. Bob and Gay were a match made in heaven. From the very start, they were. They enjoyed 62 years of marriage. They had a deep love for one another and stood strong through the storms of life. Theirs was a marriage most folks were jealous of. Bob's trademark was one of faithfulness. He was a faithful husband, father, and worker. He was a faithful churchgoer. The only time he wasn't here on the front row was when he was too sick to be here. Gay, I can't possibly speak of Bob's life without thanking you for the phenomenal care you provided him, especially after he could no longer care for himself. You were the only caregiver he ever wanted. Without you, he couldn't have stayed at home. You certainly honored your marriage vows by so lovingly caring for him until the very end. God gave you supernatural strength to care for Bob as you did. It was only appropriate that he died in your arms 2 weeks ago today. Jesus said in Matthew 12, "A good man out of the good treasure of the heart brings forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth evil things. But I say to you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by your words you shall be justified, and by your words you shall be condemned." I never heard Bob speak ill of anyone. Good treasure brought forth good things.
But if you don't know me, I was Bob's youngest son. He was retired, but he decided to take on the calling of God and raise me as his son. He adopted me at a very young age. And, you know, I don't remember a lot of the jokes and a lot of the laughter, but what I do remember is the lessons. You know, he was a man's man. He was God's man. He served not only at home, but he served in the church. I remember the lessons of teaching me patience, which was fishing. The Lord knows you got to have that to really enjoy it. Everything that we've ever had, he told me you had to work for. Nothing ever comes easy. Nothing's ever given. He taught me a work ethic that most today do not have. He's blessed this family. He's blessed my brother John, my late brother Larry, Sister Michelle, my mother. What a wonderful life. We didn't have everything, but we had all we needed. And he was always there to show us that value. This here is probably about the only picture in existence of a smile on that man's face. Both, about the most you'd ever get was a smirk, and that was usually when mom was over there pulling his ear for everything. Off of being here. I remember you again.
Anyone else want to say anything? Well, I closed out earlier with John 3:16. I want to finish the thought there. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever," we're all part of whoever, "believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed the name of God's one and only Son." You know, earlier I said there's only two classifications of people, either in Christ or not. There's not option C. And if you're in Christ, the good news is you've been made right with God. Your sins are forgiven. You become a new creation. And God has a plan for your life. If you're not in Christ, I got bad news for you. You're going to spend the rest of your life until you get that right on your own. And someday you're going to spend eternity separated from God. Separated from all this good. Separated from any hope of things getting better. I don't want to live that way. And God has given us the option. All we have to do is receive the free gift of salvation that he offers. Because I have news for you, if you haven't figured it out, one day our picture will be there. Because we have an appointment with death that we can't put off. The pal will tell you, I'll put off doctor's appointments, but I can't put off death's appointment. So what's it going to be? When that time comes, when your time comes, will the verse apply to you that precious in the sight of the Lord is the dying of his faithful servant? Or will it be depart? I never read it. That's the option. There's no option C. So if you're here today and you don't know him, you're not in Christ, it's really easy. All you have to do is repent. All you have to do is there isn't even really, we call it a sinner's prayer, but there really isn't a sinner's prayer. There is no one formula. In fact, C.S. Lewis, when he got saved, he just said, I believe, and that was it. There's no formula for it. But if you need some help, it goes something like this. God, I repent, I'm a sinner. I agree with you. And there's nothing I can do about it. So I put my faith in Christ. I put my faith in what he did on the cross for me. I ask you to forgive me of my sins, to deliver me from sin's control over my life, to create a new spirit within me. And I will live for you the rest of my life. And you know what the Bible says? If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us. You see, God doesn't want you to spend eternity separated from him. He loves you. But he's not going to force you to accept it. The choice is yours. Religion won't substitute. Trying to be a good person won't substitute. Trying to make amends won't substitute. The only provision that God has made available to us for salvation and to be right with him is through Jesus. So we know Bob took advantage of that. We know when he passed from this earth 2 weeks ago, God took note. Because precious in God's eyes was Bob's passing. And you know, when Bob closed his eyes on this earth, he opened his eyes somewhere else. And today he's finished his race. He's in the stands cheering us on. Or he may be in the stands praying, God, please bring them to you. They're lost. They're not in Christ. And if you don't bring them to you, they're going to spend eternity separated. Not only from you, but from me. And it doesn't have to be that way. Father, I thank you so much for Bob's life. And Lord, as we listen to this final song, I pray, Father, that while we're sad that he's gone, let us not be sad for where he is. That he is with you. That he is where everyone that's right with you will be one day. And so, Lord, I thank you so much for the example he set. Lord, just pray a blessing on each family here today as well. On his family members, I pray that you will comfort them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. To go to the fellowship hall, we're going to eat in just a second. If you'll just follow the hall around, it'll take you to the fellowship hall. And we're happy to have you stay with us and eat. And we're going to say the blessing now. I don't want to end on a good note.
Leftovers, y'all please come eat.
What's that?
I don't want leftovers, y'all please come eat.
Okay, no leftovers. Stanley's giving the words. Father, we thank you so much for a life well lived. We thank you, Lord, as we've tried to honor Bob today, Lord. We know that it's difficult to honor somebody who was a blessing because you always feel like you're leaving something out or not doing enough. But we thank you, Lord, that you care about your people, that you care enough, that you consider it precious in your eyes when they close their eyes the final time on this earth. And Lord, we pray that his legacy will live on. And Father, I pray for Gay that you will minister to her in a special way as she not only mourns Bob, but her son. And Lord, I just pray that she will sense your presence, your peace, like she's never sensed them before. And Father, I pray for the food we're about to eat. Pray your blessing on it, on each person who prepared it. Pray that you'll bless this time of fellowship. In Jesus' name, amen. Blessings, thank you for coming. Again, just follow the hallway around and it'll take you to the fellowship hall.